Okay, welcome, guys. I would like to declare you all gluttons for punishment. And I'm just amazed that that so many sweet, smart, good-looking people would come out on a pretty rainy day, all things considered, to study tonight. But I'll try to make it worth your while. Let's start our time off with prayer, if you don't mind. Father, we want to give this time to you and ask for your blessing in it. We thank you, Lord, for calling us in Matthew 22 to love you with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and with all of our mind. So tonight, in follow-up to what we talked about on Sunday, Lord, we offer this time of mental exercise up to you as spiritual worship. And we ask that you would accept it as such and that it be a sweet savor in your nostrils, that you be blessed by our desire to express the mind of Christ, to love you with all of our mind, and to offer that up as an act of worship to you. We pray that you would enlighten our hearts, that you would enable us to retain information that could be very helpful in the future in ministering to sons and daughters, grandsons and granddaughters, nieces and nephews, neighborhood kids, friends that we encounter at school and at work. And we count on you to help us by the power of your Holy Spirit that works mightily within us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Tonight, we're going to talk about a subject that actually we broached at New Hope about 2 years ago. And there were a number of people here. And so if you think, well, man, it seems like I've heard this before or something along these lines, you may have been here 2 years ago. If that's the case, I'll offer my apologies up front. And I'll give you your money back at the end of the show. It was a Saturday evening a couple of years ago, and we didn't have a ton of people here, so we thought we'd do a rerun and maybe get away with it. At any rate, even if you were here, I think this might be a good refresher, because most of this material you probably haven't seen between then and now. The subject that we're going to look at, what can we know about Jesus from evidence outside the Bible, comes at you for two reasons. I was constantly, as a professor, getting questions from previous students or from pastors, youth pastors, ministers, Chi Alpha ministers, you know, people ministering in a college context, on a college campus, getting this question, look, I'm being told by, or I've read on an internet website or whatever, that there's no evidence for the existence of Jesus, much less all the stuff that the Bible asserts about him, the main points of his biography, if you take the Bible out of the equation. So is there any evidence that you can help me with that I could share with my youth group or with my Chi Alpha group or with the people who are asking me questions at work or on the college campus where I attend that would be some sort of an answer to that challenge, that there's no evidence that Jesus ever even existed if you take the Bible out of the equation. And so I knew that there was. I didn't know how much there was. I didn't know how detailed and how ancient this material was. But I decided I would go ahead and look into that and research that. So that's the reason why it comes to you tonight. This is a way of equipping you, and maybe even for some of you, helping ground your faith in historical reality, in something that has been not only divinely revealed in Scripture, but also verified in material outside the Bible. What I'm going to bring to you tonight comes from the pens of practically every author whose works you're going to see reflected tonight are not just non-Christian, they are anti-Christian. with one exception, and that's Josephus Flavius, and he will deal with him right at the very beginning. So there's one author who is kind of, he's on the fence. He's neither positive nor negative toward Jesus and early Christianity. All of the other sources that you will see reflected are antagonistic toward Jesus and early Christianity. And the material that they're giving us is not coming from their reading of biblical stuff, but is coming from their own personal opinion, having heard the Jesus message somewhere out there in society, out in the public domain, out in the market square. Okay, can you get me the first slide? Thank you. The material that you might want to look into that is of a Christian origin, I've already written on, and this is a article is archived, and so you have free access to it. All you've got to do is write down the web address, and if you type that into your web browser and hit go or arrow or search, it will take you directly to that source. You don't have to sort out a bunch of other stuff, but this discusses some of that material that is after the New Testament, that is Christian in origin, about Jesus, and on four major topics. Some of you may have heard of the Jesus Seminar. It's a group of scholars that meet regularly and vote on what they believe Jesus actually said and didn't say, that kind of thing. You familiar with the Jesus Seminar? Then maybe put that in a Google search and kind of get up to speed on that. I think that their work is interesting but sad, because they are, in the words of the great church father Epiphanius, they are searching for a Jesus that never existed, and in so doing, they have lost the only Jesus that ever did exist, but in reality, they've only lost themselves. But they're the go-to people in almost every time that the mainstream media wants to do a Christmas special or an Easter special on faith, people of faith, objects of faith, world religions, Christianity, Judaism, that kind of thing. They go and they get the interviews that they get for their specials, for their, quote, documentaries, from these, quote, specialists, most of them being very left-leaning scholars and even Jesus Seminar scholars. And they've come to the conclusion that about 87% of what the New Testament says Jesus said was actually just made up by other people much later, because they wanted to put words in Jesus' mouth so that what they had to say would have more authority. So their conclusion is that we can't really know anything about the real historical Jesus on the basis of the material in the Gospels. I think you'll find a very interesting challenge to that in this material, because not only is the New Testament saying very specific things about Jesus, this stuff outside the Bible is also saying very specific things about Jesus, and the two actually fit quite well with one another, overlay quite well with one another, and we'll make that point when we get to the end. Let me see the next slide. Now we're going to start on stuff not by Christians, that's covered by the article, but we're going to be dealing with material in these slides that come from people who are primarily, except for this one guy, Josephus Flavius, everybody else is antagonistic toward Christianity. Josephus was born and died as a traditional Jew, not a believer in Jesus. So here's the text that we have from the Arabic version of Josephus's works. At this time, there was a wise man who was called Jesus, and his conduct was good, and he was known to be virtuous. Okay, so far, I want you to be thinking in comparison, what do I know from the Bible? What are these texts telling me? And many people from among the Jews and other nations became his disciples. Jesus had disciples. So not only did he exist, he also had disciples. Pilate condemned him to be crucified and to die. Okay, now we know that he was executed by a Roman governor whose name was Pilate. We know of him from archaeology and other ancient sources, as well as the New Testament. And so now we're told about what kind of person he was, what kind of death he died, exactly how he was executed. And those who, next slide, had become his disciples did not abandon his discipleship. Do we know that from the book of Acts? From the letters? Yeah, we do. And they reported that he appeared to them 3 days after his crucifixion and that he was alive. Is that what we get from the New Testament? Okay, well, that's not made up either then. You can question whether that was true or not, but what I'm saying is you've got a set of texts in the Bible that claim by the original disciples of Jesus that he appeared to them resurrected from the dead after being crucified as a criminal. Now we have another author, not a biblical author, not a Christian, who's saying, yeah, that's exactly what they said. So this is not something that's made up by some later Greek and Roman church years and years, decades, centuries maybe, after the actual events out in the Greco-Roman world, who just got this from some tradition that somebody made up somewhere and passed it on, and now they're happening to write it down, and then it becomes one of our gospels. This is a first century source. First century AD. 20 centuries, 21 now centuries ago, we have a non-Christian, a traditional Jewish guy, who is writing the same stuff that we get in our Gospels, in the book of Acts, and in the letters of Paul. He appeared to them 3 days after his crucifixion and that he was alive. Accordingly, he was perhaps the Messiah. Josephus, to his credit, at least is not antagonistic toward early Christianity or toward Jesus. He's holding it open as a possibility that what these people in the first, this is a first century document, in the first century were saying about their master, crucified, buried, resurrected. Concerning whom the prophets have recounted wonders. The word wonders there is a technical term, comes to us out of Hebrew, the Hebrew Bible first, then the New Testament, and it means who have recounted, this person is going to do miracles. So what have we learned from Josephus Flavius, a first century born Jewish historian who was a contemporary of the apostles, is writing at the same time the New Testament is being written, so he's not reading the New Testament. This is not where he's getting this from. He's getting this from out in the public domain. The Gospels, for him, don't even exist yet. He probably doesn't have access to them anyway. Remember, no printing press, no digital, you know, file sharing, no satellite uplinks, that kind of thing. So the Gospels are just when he's writing beginning to come online, and Josephus knows some really important aspects about the life and death and ministry and significance of Jesus of Nazareth. He even knows his technical term, Mashiach, Messiah. Let's take a look at the next slide. Josephus has another report. He doesn't have one, he has two. One of them is in his Antiquities of the Jews, book 18, and we just read that. This one comes later, at the very end of his Antiquities of the Jews, in the last book, book 20. And there he says, and Annas, the high priest, who by the way is a descendant of Annas and Caiaphas, who had Jesus crucified or participated in that at the very beginning, and Annas, the high priest, thought that he had a favorable opportunity because the procurator Festus, who we read about in the New Testament, by the way, right, in the book of Acts, Festus was one of those later Roman governors that imprisoned Paul and put Paul on trial, that Festus was dead and that Albinus, his successor, was still on the way. And so he convened the judges of the Sanhedrin and brought before them a man named James. Now this is James, the brother of Jesus, half-brother actually. Same mother, different father, okay? And so this James, the brother of Jesus, who was called the Christ. There you have the Greek Christos, which is reflective of the Hebrew Mashiach or Messiah, who was called the Christ and certain others. And so again, Josephus knows of this, the first century Jew who lived in the land of Israel, knows of a man whose name is Jesus, whose nickname is, or title, or whatever you want to call it, who is the Anointed One, the Christ. Same thing that the New Testament calls Jesus. Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Messiah, and certain others. He accused them of having transgressed the law and delivered them up to be stoned. This is a story that we don't hear of in the New Testament. But this is happening in AD 62. We know these dates exactly because we, from other sources, know exactly when these Roman procurators or military governors started their rule in the land of Israel and then were eventually recalled by the Roman government. So this is a secure date, AD 62. We hear about the death of James, the brother of Jesus, the author of the book of James in the New Testament, and the leader of the early church, according to texts like the book of Galatians and Acts 15. This is a significant event. Josephus knows more about it than the New Testament tells us. Tells us about James's martyrdom. Next text. There is a gentleman by the name of Tholos who wrote in middle of the 5th decade A.D., middle of the first century, AD 55. And by the way, you'll see that I have put the dates as well as the exact locations of these quotes so that if anybody has interest in doing this, then you can run these down yourself to make sure that the quote that I have given you is correct, that the dating is correct and relevant, and anyone else that you might want to share this material with can also date check. They can fact check this. This is not something I'm standing up here making up. It's the neat thing about being a researcher. If you're not creative, at least be able to find good stuff somewhere, right? So that's my lot in life. At any rate, Tholos writes a history in the middle of the first century, and he tells this story in his history about one day there was a solar eclipse. There was darkness in the middle of the day. That is exactly what happens in the midst of the crucifixion. There is a solar eclipse and the earth becomes dark at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, which is the precise time that Jesus dies, which, by the way, if you'll compare what Josephus says and what the rabbis say in the Mishnah, 3 o'clock in the afternoon is the exact to the minute time when the priests in the temple began to slaughter the Passover sacrificial offerings that are going to be consumed, going to be eaten as the dinner, the Passover dinner, that night beginning at sundown. They call it the day of preparation of the Passover. So his death coincides to the minute to the beginning of the sacrifice of sacrificial Passover lambs in the temple for that year. Okay, next. Mara ben Serapion, we have a text of an Aramaic letter from approximately AD 70. I've put on there AD 73. That's as young as it can be. That's as late as it could possibly have been written. And this man, who is not a Christian, is writing to his son, and he's arguing a point that is really not relevant for us, but it's basically don't do dumb stuff. It's what a son would need to be told by his father. Or am I living in an alternate universe? My dad used to tell me that all the time. Stop doing dumb stuff. You'll suffer less. But anyway, what advantage did the Jews gain by killing their wise king? This is only AD 73, and it has to have already happened. There's only real one option, to identify this, his point of reference historically. It has to be the death of Jesus. So again, we have an illustration, an example from the first century AD, the same century that Jesus lived, died, and was resurrected in. Not more than about 4 decades afterward, and you've got a non-Christian who's making reference to this. What advantage did the Jews gain in killing their wise king? And by the way, it's also telling us something about Jesus. He was a wise person, which, by the way, Josephus also said, right? Which we also see in our Gospels. Okay, next text. Pliny the Younger. Pliny the Younger is an official in the Roman hierarchy. He is a governor of the district of Bithynia, which we hear about in the New Testament. We hear about it in Acts chapter 16. It's a fascinating story. This is just a little bit of an aside, but it's worthwhile, so go there with me. When Bithynia comes up in the New Testament narrative, Acts 16, Paul is out on the mission field, and he's wanting to go to his next kind of target area for his ministry. And it says in the book of Acts, in Acts 16, that Paul wanted to go to Mysia, but the Spirit of the Lord hindered him. Then he wanted to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus would not permit him. And this, to many Christians, is like, really? Why not? There are people there who need to hear about Jesus. There are folks there that need to be saved. There are folks there whose lives would be transformed and radicalized if they would begin to follow Messiah Jesus. But that's what the Bible says. Have you ever read those texts in Acts 16? So Paul goes to bed that night and he has a vision, and it changes history. It says that a Macedonian man appeared to him in a vision and said, come over and help us. And so instead of going to Mysia, instead of going to Bithynia, Paul's ministry is directed by God to go west, to go in the direction of Macedonia, where he founds churches like the great church at Philippi. Remember the Philippian jailer? Gets saved. The church at Philippi, it ends up resulting in the book of Philippians in the New Testament. He ends up founding churches like the church at Thessaloniki. We get 1st and 2nd Thessalonians out of that. We hear about another church that is founded in between those two spots, the church at Berea. Remember, the Bereans were more noble because they searched the scriptures to see if those things were so. We get that kind of stuff, and we get the birth, largely speaking, of Western Christianity that ends up going all the way to Italy, Spain, France, England, and others. So then, is this all at the Bithynians' expense? They just get to go to hell in a handbasket? What we hear from this pagan governor, Pliny the Younger, in his letters back and forth between him and the emperor, whose name was Trajan, the emperor of the Roman Empire, is that Christianity had become so pervasive in the province of Bithynia that all the pagan temples were going out of business. That the price of an average sacrificial animal was down in the floor. It's like the stock market had crashed on paganism in Bithynia, because by the year AD 111, this is 110, 111, when this correspondence between the Roman governor Pliny and the Roman emperor Trajan was taking place, he says Christianity, that Bithynia is eaten up with Christianity. So somebody, it wasn't Paul, but somebody got the message to those Bithynians. It wasn't that God was anti-Bithynian, it was that God was pro his own plan in the life of Paul, and he said, I've got other people that can take care of Bithynia. That's kind of Paul Harvey's, the rest of the story behind Acts 16. So I just thought you might want to encounter that. And if you've ever tripped over God's Spirit saying, no, I don't want you to go witness to those folks. I don't want you to go preach to those people. I don't want you to found churches, cast out demons, perform cures, and see people saved over in Bithynia, because you know what? I'm God, and I've just decided I kind of hate Bithynians, you know? That's not what's going on big picture at all, because we have the record. In fact, there's a really interesting thing. Anybody interested, any of you ladies interested in women and ministry? One of the earliest references, it's not the earliest, but one of the earliest references to women in ministry comes from this set of correspondence. He said he actually had two deacons and they were female deacons, and he had tortured them, trying to get them to recount their, deny their faith in Jesus, and they refused. They stood fast. What am I supposed to do with these two female deacons? Do I go ahead and put them to death? Do I release them? Do I charge them with certain, you know, you're forbidden from this point on to do this, that, or the other? But you've got this beautiful story of women in leadership in the church who are standing in the face of intense persecution, and they are not denying their faith in Jesus. So rock on, ladies. But then back to our original point of departure. This is what Pliny says with respect to Jesus. The Christians, this is AD 111, just after the death of the last apostle, just after the final words were penned in whatever was the last book of Revelation, I think it might be the Gospel of John, in New Testament documents. The Christians, were in the habit of meeting on a certain fixed day before sunrise and reciting an antiphonal hymn to Christ as God. That means they sang congregationally. They sang together. A hymn to Christ as God. So you have this story of, or this letter from a Roman governor, a Roman official, writing to the emperor, and he's talking about Jesus, Christ, and he's saying that people in Bithynia, at the very end of the first century, beginning of the second century, are worshiping Jesus as divine. That's pretty cool, huh? Okay, this is not in the Bible, so you can't blame anybody in the Bible like Paul or John or whatever for high Christology, a high view of Jesus. And that this is something that at the Council of Nicaea in 325, Constantine convinced everybody to worship Jesus as kind of like a Roman god. Sorry, this is 200 plus years before that. Forget about Da Vinci Code. Forget about Dan Brown. That was all baloney. That was designed to make somebody a millionaire, and it did, in spades, big time. It's not about the truth, it's about the bakshish, okay? Cornelius Tacitus, this is an official Roman historian who has access to the official Roman archives in the capital city. Tacitus says, in his annals, you got to be careful with how you spell and pronounce that word. So just practice it in the shower or something like that. Nero substituted as culprits and punished in the most unusual ways those who were hated for their shameful acts, whom the crowd called Christianoi. The O-I is just a plural. It means S in English. What does that look like to you? Christians, exactly. And where does that word Christian come from? The word Christ. It means Christ followers. Christiani. Christianoi. The founder of this name, Christ, there it is. He's the one who told us. Had suffered the extreme penalty, which is just a euphemism for crucifixion, during the reign of Tiberius at the hands of one of our procurators, Pontius Pilate. How about that? That's from a Roman, an official Roman historian in the early second century. Next slide. Suppressed for a time, this deadly superstition, some translations read this pernicious superstition, others read this demonic superstition, erupted again, not only in Judea, the origin of this evil, by the way, you notice he's talking geographically. Where does Christianity first erupt? Day of Pentecost? The city of Jerusalem, right? It's the epicenter. It's kind of interesting that Christianity conquers the conqueror, Rome, backward. Isn't that kind of historical irony? Rome conquers from the west to the east. Christianity conquers the conquerors from east to west. Starts in Jerusalem and ends in Rome. That's the way the book of Acts runs. You'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. And at the end of the book of Acts, where is Paul? Acts 28, Rome, exactly. Right? Suppress for a time the deadly superstition erupted not only in Judea, the origin of this evil, but also in the city, meaning Rome, where all things horrible and shameful. He's referring to Christianity there. Cherish that. Feel it. Enjoy it. This guy's calling your chosen faith one of the things that are horrible and shameful. From everywhere, collect together. The mental image is like a sewer running together that he's trying to paint with words and letters. Everything horrible and shameful from everywhere come together and become popular. Therefore, they were covered with the skins of wild animals and torn to death by dogs, or they were crucified when the day ended. And then they were burned as torches. And this was in Nero's garden, Nero the emperor. Okay, so he knows about this first official Christian persecution by the emperor Nero. Nero made Christians in Rome a scapegoat. He's actually the one who set the fire. And he simply wanted, it was part of his plan for urban renewal in the city of Rome. And so then when he got a lot of blowback from it, he decided he needed a scapegoat and the Christians were an easy target. Fascinating stuff. But this is the kind of stuff that we're told about an official Roman by an official Roman historian in the early 2nd century AD, Cornelius Tacitus. A contemporary of Cornelius Tacitus is Suetonius. Suetonius was not an official Roman historian, but he was one who kind of like was writing Reader's Digest versions of the histories of Cornelius Tacitus. This was the popularized version. This is kind of like the NASB versus the Message. So Suetonius is telling a lot of the same history, a lot of the same stories. He's just writing it in a popularized kind of way for your average Roman to read and digest as sort of, you know, interesting reading. So Suetonius writes, note his dates, in his life of Claudius, that Claudius expelled the Jews from Rome, and I've put my little bracket there. This was an event that happened in AD 49, middle of the first century, and is mentioned in the book of Acts. There in Acts 18, Paul has recently come to the city of Corinth, and he meets some Jews from Rome named Aquila and Priscilla. Do you remember this story? And it's like, well, if you lived in Rome, what are you doing here in Corinth? It's because of this this expulsion of Jews from the city of Rome. Now, Suetonius is going to explain why that edict, that command from the emperor was issued. It says, because they were always making disturbances on account of the instigator Crestus. And we already saw that word. Remember the Christianoi, the Christians? Okay, so this is on account of Jesus, on account of Christ. In other words, there were disturbances within the Jewish community in the capital city of Rome. And the thing that was causing this difference of opinion, these disturbances, was Jesus. Enough so that there were constant problems within the Jewish community. So finally, Claudius pulled the plug on them all. He said, okay, everybody, you take your little Jesus problem and get out of town. Eventually, when Claudius died, his edict became what is called technically a dead letter, and meaning that it is null and void. It's kind of like an executive order. Whenever the president in our governmental system gives an executive order at the end of his term in office, unless the next president renews that executive order, then that executive order dies. Thank God. Yes? Get the boot of the emperor off my back too. Okay, never mind. Next slide, please. Suetonius again. Now this is a different work of his, the life of Nero. And that life of Nero, now he's running parallel with his contemporary Tacitus, who told about the human torches in the gardens. Suetonius is going to take us back to that. This is pre-AD 64, this is AD 64. Punishment was inflicted upon the Christiani, a class of people of a new and evil doing superstition. The word evil doing superstition is basically a demonically inspired religion. So again, cherish that, because he's talking about your chosen faith. These are not friends of Christianity or of Jesus or the apostles. In this particular slide, he's going to start this story about a persecution that is taking place in AD 64. This is well within the lives of Peter, folks that we know of, like John, the son of Zebedee. AD 64 is when, according to the early church father, Tertullian of Carthage, who was writing around 180 AD, this was the persecution that took the life of Paul by beheading and the life of Peter by crucifixion, upside down, right? All right, so this is the AD 64. Next slide. Lucian of Samosata is an author of some type of free-flowing history. A really interesting author, on his own, irrespective of what he says about Jesus. But in his work called The Death of Peregrinus, here we have Lucian's words about Jesus and early Christianity. Peregrinus, the person that he's written this story about, was second only to that one whom they still worship today. You worship deities, right? Not humans, you worship people who are divine in their nature, whom they still worship today. The man in Palestine who was crucified because he brought this new form of initiation into the world, a new form of religion is what he's trying to say. I'm not convinced that he's right, but we'll go with that. That the first lawgiver of theirs persuaded them that they are all brothers. You know, we hear this kind of language in the New Testament, right? If your brother slaps you on the cheek, turn to him the other also. If your brother accuses you, Jesus uses that kind of covenantal language, brothers, right? The moment they transgress and deny the Greek gods and begin worshiping that crucified philosopher and living by his laws, okay? This is fascinating stuff, right? And there's only one person that fills that bill. He brought a new set of laws. He called people brothers. He was crucified. He was a wise person, a sophist. This word philosopher comes from that philosophus, means someone who exercises, teaches wisdom. Began worshiping that crucified teacher of wisdom and living by his laws. That can only be Jesus. There's no other person in history that we know of that matches those sorts of descriptives. Next, Celsus in True Doctrine. You see the dates there where Celsus wrote this book, and a lot of the quotes come to us from an early church father whose name is Origen. He was a bishop in Caesarea. That's the Caesarea on the sea, not Caesarea Philippi. Okay, so Celsus says, according to Origen, says this. Celsus says he fabricated the story of his birth from a virgin. Oh, wow. Now we're getting virgin birth. This guy's disagreeing with it. He's saying Jesus made that up, but he knows about it. He knows about it in the early first century, and he doesn't know about it because he's sitting around studying the Gospel of Matthew a whole lot or the Gospel of Luke a whole lot. He knows about this because he's gotten this from public domain, from people preaching and teaching and stories being shared. But it ends up being the same message that we have in the New Testament. He fabricated the story of his birth from a virgin. He came from a Jewish village. That would be, you know the name of this village? Nazareth, exactly. And it was a Jewish village. It's up in Lower Galilee. There aren't any Gentiles living there. It's up on the first ridge as you head north out of the Jezreel Valley. We've been there, haven't we, Pastor? By the way, we're going to be there where Jesus grew up in March. I'm assuming you will be there with us.
It's unbelievable.
is it? To actually be there, to see the archaeology of first century homes that you can walk right up to. It's not behind glass. It's not like they keep you way back, like you have to look at a ball game in a basketball stadium. You're right there at it, where people tether their animals, where they would cook their bread in these ovens, and where they had their little silo. They're sort of like a predecessor of a refrigerator. And you're right there walking through first century Nazareth. We go to the Church of the Annunciation, where that marks the spot where the angel said to Mary, "Blessed are you among women." I say that to my wife all the time. I don't get quite the same rise, but, you know, I guess it's the difference between me and Gabriel, right? Okay, way above my pay grade. All right. Jewish village, from a poor country woman. Is that right? Yep, that's right. Who gained her substance, now listen to this, by spinning. We're not told that in the New Testament. So this guy is already off the menu. He's not reading the Gospel of Luke or the Gospel of Matthew and getting this stuff from that. This is stuff that's out there floating around in this late first century, early second century world. That she was driven out by her husband, who was a carpenter by trade. The driven out is a technical term for divorced. She was removed from his home. It's the same language you read in the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament. Who was driven out by her husband, who was a carpenter by trade. You ever heard that before? Is this not the son of Joseph the carpenter? Exactly. And when she was convicted of adultery, and we hear this. We hear this kind of stuff in the New Testament, like in John 8, where the leaders say to Jesus, "Look, we know who our father was, but as for you, aren't you a Samaritan? And have a demon?" That's like the worst ethnic slur that you could possibly throw at somebody. To call a Jew a Samaritan is to, well, you can probably do the math in your mind. Convicted of adultery and had a child by a soldier named Pantera. Pantera, which is a play on the word Parthenos. And the word Parthenos means virgin in Greek. Like the Parthenon on the Acropolis, in Greece, where there were the Vestal virgins, priestesses, who were kept apart from the rest of humanity and preserved their chasteness and served the gods in that kind of way. That the Parthenon, Parthenos, Pantera. It's just a play on words. She had a child by a soldier named Panthera, and after she had been driven out by her husband, and while she was wandering disgracefully, she secretly bore Jesus. Because Jesus was poor, foxes have their holes, and birds of the air have their, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. We know this stuff. We know this stuff. And he knew it too, but not through the Gospels. He knew it because this was the story that the early church was telling even before there were Gospels to pass around. He hired himself out as a laborer in Egypt. And the Lord spoke to Joseph in a dream and said, "Take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt, because there are those who are seek the child's life." So they stay in Egypt for a period of time, and then the angel of the Lord appears to Joseph in another dream and says, "Those who sought the child's life are now dead. Arise, take the child and his mother and return to the land of Israel." This is stuff we get in the Gospel of Matthew. He was in Egypt. Amazing stuff, isn't it? And he acquired there certain magical powers that the Egyptians are proud to have. Magical powers. What do you do with magic? You work wonders. That's what Josephus said. The prophets had recounted wonders that this Messiah would do, and he applied that to Jesus, that the Messiah would be a wonder worker, a miracle worker. All right? Now, in the Gospels, when Jesus does miraculous stuff, like casting demons out of demon-possessed people with a word? What was it that the authorities said? Yes, he's casting out demons, but he's doing it by the power of Beelzebub. They're saying he's doing this, all of these miraculous works, by the power of the dark side of the Schwartz, right? Yes? And so it's the same claim. You get this in the Gospels, you get this in this extra biblical literature. Yes, we have to admit he was a miraculous person. He had a miraculous ministry. He did wonders. But he was using the dark side. He was using the power of the dark side, not the power of the light side, the good God side. Okay? He returned full of pride in these powers, woe, and he gave to him the self, the title of God. There again, you have cropping up in one of these very early sources, the deity, the divinity of Christ. This is not something that was made up at the Council of Nicaea in AD 325, where people all of a sudden discovered that Jesus was divine, and we're going to start worshiping him now. That's what Dan Brown wrote in his book, The Da Vinci Code. Da Vinci Code. It's a subliminal thing. I do it to my students at back in Springfield all the time. Dan Brown wrote a book that then became a hit movie, The Da Vinci Code. But Dan Brown was wrong. It's okay. It's a human thing. To err is human. Okay, so you ever done any erring? My wife will tell you, I do it all the time. Yeah. To err is, yeah, my husband. All right. So Dan Brown made a big mistake. He was wrong, and the world paid for it. I got a call from my mother-in-law, who I dearly love. She's my favorite mother-in-law. One Saturday morning, I was still half asleep. Answered the phone and, hello, Miss Pat. Hey, why didn't you tell us that there were really actually not four but 80 Gospels, and that the reason that most of them didn't get into the New Testament is because the Emperor Constantine wrangled all of these church leaders together and made them vote on the four, because those were the ones that that taught that Jesus was God and stuff like that. And I went, wait a minute, I'd never even heard the name Dan Brown. Didn't know the name, the title Da Vinci Code. It just wasn't on my radar yet. And I went, whoa, slow down. What are you talking about? And so then she tells me, I just finished reading this book, because she's an avid reader. And I went, that's pretty checked out. But let me look into it and I'll get back to you. This is kind of a part of that getting back to. Kind of got back at her, not to her. All right, so Jesus was poor, hired himself as a laborer in Egypt, learned magical powers, and came back with great pride in these powers and gave to him the self the title of God. Fascinating stuff. Outside the New Testament, but all kinds of stuff that is roughly parallel with things that we've read about for years. Next. The next piece of material is not a text, but it's actually, it is a text. It's an inscription and a picture that has come to us from archaeology. This picture dates to sometime between 125 and 150 AD and comes to us from the catacombs in Rome. And it is a picture of one guy, maybe a neighbor, making fun of another guy that he knows. Let's take a look. It's not real easy to see, but we'll do a little photo enhancement here. Before we leave this one, look and see if you can see up at the very top of the picture, right in the middle of the frame, what looks like a donkey's head. A donkey's head looking to the right like this. And then look below that and see if you can see outstretched arms. Can you make that out? And then the trunk of a body and then legs. And you'll see that this person is affixed to a cross. Let's take a look at from another angle. This is just a different photo exposure, and there you can see it pretty clearly. And you can also see that there's a guy just below the crucified victim's right hand, and that person is standing on the ground just a little bit below, and he's lifting one arm up in worship. OK? Okay? You may have done this Sunday when we were together. Do you know that this business of lifting up the hands in worship goes all the way back to people like King David? It shows up in Psalm 28. I lift my hands in your name. That kind of language. So it's actually biblical. I've had Israelis say, why do you Christians lift your hands up? I said, because y'all taught us to. I'm just having fun with people like Ofer who deserve it. Yeah. I rage against the normal world. I think that's why they call it Waves World. Party on, Waves, right? Okay, look at the bottom where you see there that there is writing. There are actually some letters that you can make out. Now let's go to an artist's reconstruction of this whole thing. There you see the man at the on one side. You see the crucified victim who actually has a donkey's and ass's head. This is a popular conception of both the God of Israel and of the crucified Jesus by people who disagreed with Judaism and Christianity. Now take a look down at the bottom, and there you'll see a Greek inscription that says, Alexamenos worships his God. And again, we see Jesus, the crucified victim, being worshiped and being called God. Take a look at the translation. Isn't that fascinating? Do you think that the guy that drew that picture of the crucified Jesus was pro-Jesus? He wouldn't have done it with a donkey's head, would he? And do you think that he is agreeing with or making fun of whoever Alexamenos was? Yeah, he was deriding him as that pernicious superstition, that superstition that worships demon deities, demon personages. I'm not sure. I'm not as good on my American history as I am my ancient biblical history. So next slide. How's that for a segue? I'm not sure if elephant is any more complimentary at all. Yeah, kind of reminds me of a woman of some area. I know. Okay, we're now into a section of this presentation that deals with the works of the early rabbis, the teachings of the early rabbis. One of the earliest rabbinic texts is one that we were talking about a lot last night, the Mishnah. It's a collection of rabbinic discussions and decisions and teachings and parables and that kind of thing. And a companion volume to the Mishnah is another one called the Tosefta. Tosefta means simply additions to the Mishnah. And so here you will hear the rabbis say, it is taught that Rabbi Eliezer said to the sages, did not Ben Stada bring spells from Egypt in a cut in his flesh? Again, you hear this kind of code language, Ben Stada. We'll hear that explained in just a minute, so hold that there. But somebody's bringing back magical spells from Egypt. Already, we're starting to think, there's something up here. This is about somebody that I know, somebody that died for me, somebody that I pray to and worship. Okay, next. Ben Stada is Ben Pantera. What is Ben Pantera? The son of the Virgin. Remember? Pantir, Panteras, Parthenos. Okay, so the Ben Stada is the son of the Virgin. Ben Hisda said, the husband was Stada, the lover was Pantera. The mother was Miriam. Who does that sound like? Mary. Would it surprise you if I told you that in your Bible, that word has been preserved for Mary, the mother of Jesus? You see, we have four Gospels. One of them is by Luke. Luke often preserves, for whatever reason, I don't know why, he's a Gentile. Maybe he's hung out with Paul for so long. But he preserves a lot of Hebraic stuff, stuff from the Hebrew language. And not Matthew, not Mark, and not John, but Luke preserves the original Hebrew version of Mary's name. And guess what it is? Miriam. Miriam. She's named maybe for the sister of Moses, remember, that led the worship at the sea in Exodus 15? But probably not. She was probably named for a famous and majorly beloved Maccabean princess whose name was Miriamne. Miriam, who lived not long before Jesus died and was one of Herod the Great's wives. She didn't survive him. He had four and killed them all. That's the Herod we know and love that killed the babies in Bethlehem. He had a bunch of sons and killed a number of them as well. So to the point that Augustus Caesar, one of his best friends, said, "I'd rather be Herod's pig than Herod's son," which was in Greek a play on the word pig and son, which sound a lot alike. All right. The husband is Stata, the lover was Pantera, the mother was Miriam, the dresser of men's hair. Now we heard that she was a spinner, and now we're hearing that she was a hairdresser. She was probably multi-talented, okay? Most women can multitask. She's a woman. She's talented. She does what you do what you have to do to survive. Okay, so Miriam, the dresser of women's hair, and she was false to her husband. Again, we hear about this claim. It's one reason why you have genealogies of Jesus in both Matthew and Luke to demonstrate that he had a legitimate genealogy. Why is that? Because there's a charge that he's not legitimate. In John chapter 8, again, the charge is that Jesus is illegitimate, that the leaders know who their father is, that Jesus does not. That Jesus is some kind of hybrid, half-breed, sort of non-Jewish, Samaritan, whatever. I'll never forget watching Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ, which is an amazing movie. At one point, there are some people up on the city wall, and Jesus has been arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane. By the way, we walk all of that stuff when we're in Israel. We'll sit down and have a long discussion about things like trials and crucifixion and why Jesus didn't leave and go somewhere else when he could very easily have, right there at the Garden of Gethsemane in March. And I'll, again, look forward to having that conversation with you there. So we'll just pay that forward. You okay with that? Thank you very much. Okay? So we'll continue that discussion there. But this idea that mother was that Jesus was some kind of way not kosher, not legitimate. The people on the wall were yelling at him as he was led away in chains. They were yelling at him in Hebrew, "Mamzer." Mamzer, M-A-M-Z-E-R. If you don't like to curse and you feel like that's not very sanctified, then you could use that word because nobody would know what you're talking about. So you'd be cursing, but you'd get away with it. I'm not sure what the moral of that story is. Anyway, it's a Hebrew word, and it means one who is of illegitimate birth. I'll let you fill in the blanks. All right, next slide. Babylonian Talmud, this is another rabbinic work. In the tractate that is called Sanhedrin, and there's the page number. All of these quotes, I've given you the exact location where they come from. For your unbelieving friends, relatives, co-workers, neighbors, maybe even people you don't like, whoever ends up getting this material, it's all there for them. Jesus escaped to Egypt. Yeah. Matthew chapter 2, right? Jesus escaped to Egypt, and a teacher, and this is a technical phrase in Hebrew, a teacher has said, that means in the very earliest rabbinic tradition, just a way of saying it in that doesn't come through very well in translation, but it's a technical term, Tanakh. It means the earliest rabbinic tradition is that Jesus the Nazarene, Jesus from Nazareth, there you got his hometown, and that's what he's called in the Gospels too. Is this not the prophet Jesus of Nazareth, right? Practiced magic and led Israel astray. Not just that he had these spells that he learned in Egypt and that he was able to work wonders, but he used it to lead the people astray. Now, what that means is that you're a false prophet, a la Deuteronomy 13. If a prophet arises and he shows a sign or a wonder, or he makes a prediction and it comes to pass, but then he leads the people astray to the worship of other gods, then he's to be put to death as a false prophet. Not all false prophets were put to death. False prophets who lead astray to the worship of other gods. So this business of leading Israel astray has to do with leading Israel away from the one true God. Now, what would that mean? That he led them into worship of him. And that's always been a sticking point, a stumbling block, a problem for the Jewish community. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. So how do we get away as Orthodox Christians today with worshiping God the Father and God the Son? Because Jesus, the same Jesus who lived this stuff, who supposedly, quote, led Israel astray, said, I and the Father are. And that goes right back to Deuteronomy chapter 6. He's saying this is not some kind of a repudiation of what we have always confessed as Jews. This is an amplification. This is simply saying there are multiple aspects of this nature of God. Like if you looked at a diamond and you turned it around and you looked at it from different perspectives and in different lights, you would see different facets of that diamond. It's all the same diamond. If you looked at Wave Nunnally, you would see, yes, there's Wave Nunnally, who is the son of Wave and May Nunnally. But you would also be looking at me and saying, yes, that's the husband of Lacey Nunnally and also the father of Jacob and Abby Nunnally. And you would be saying, and that's the grandfather of Esther and Zion and Lydia Hibbert and whoever we get next month when he's downloaded. So, yeah, I'm told his name is going to be Magnus. Magnus, yeah, I've already declared that my nickname for him is going to be Rivii, which in Hebrew means the fourth one. They can name him what they want. For me, he's already Rivii, number four. It would be better than Quattro, wouldn't it? Yeah. Huh? Everybody knows what that means. All right, so Jesus escaped to Egypt. A teacher said he practiced magic and led Israel astray. This is the claim of the religious leadership in the Gospels themselves. So do you think that maybe that stuff, this animosity between Jesus and the religious leadership, especially the temple leadership, was just made up by later Christians to try to throw people off because really he was a revolution leader and the Romans just captured him, were able to get him using betrayers and stuff like that. And this was really a big Jesus versus Rome, Jesus versus the empire kind of thing. No, this has very much religious connotations and it has to do with Jesus' self-claims, his claims about himself. That is, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. And by the way, if people get on your case about being exclusivistic or elitist or, well, you're just you're trying to make everybody believe like you, look, you didn't say that. He did. Just throw that right over on him. Say, you don't have anything to do with me. Don't take this up with me. Take this up with him. And I assure you, he's got really broad shoulders and he can handle that kind of scrutiny. But then remind them, and by the way, this, when you go and complain to him about this, you know, making the narrow way so narrow and the gate so narrow, just remember, by the way, that he loved you enough that he bled his life's blood out for you. And he's your hope. He was trying to punch your ticket for a positive eternity. Just remember that when you're bringing this complaint to him about making the claims of Christianity so exclusivistic. But guess what? I'm about 2,000 years too late to change all that. So don't complain to me. I didn't start this. That do that with people. You're just trying to make everybody else believe like you. You're just being elitist, you know? No, I'm just telling you this is what Jesus said. You know, the one that died for you. Remember that guy? Yeah. Okay, next. Another Babylonian Talmud. The rabbis taught Jesus had five disciples. Actually, it was 12, and then 11, and then 12 again. But we're not going to quibble too much. These people know that Jesus was a rabbi because only rabbis have disciples. And he's a rabbi because he has disciples, and they know, or they think they know, some of the names of these guys, okay? So this tradition is telling us Jesus was a rabbi, he had disciples, and here's some of them. Matai, that's the Hebrew version, Matai, Matityahu, whatever you want to say, of Matthew. Okay, that's an easy one, right? That was a slam dunk, you're way ahead of me on that. How about Nakai? Nakai. The other places in rabbinic literature know about a guy whose name is Nachdimon ben Gurion Migalil from Galilee. Nachdimon. Nicodemus, exactly. John chapter 3. He was a disciple of Jesus. He was a rabbi. He was a teacher of the law. And he came to Jesus by night. He's kind of slipping around at first. Later, he really showed his cards, and he was a part with Joseph of Arimathea in the burial of Jesus. And in the early 2nd century AD, there was actually a gospel written whose name is the Gospel According to Nicodemus. So there's an early Christian tradition that he became a very strong follower of Jesus. I pray for his sake that's the case. At any rate, Nicodemus. Another one is Netzer. Well, that one actually is Jesus. It's the Hebrew word for the branch. You know, that branch, that stem from the root of David. I thought the root had been, and the tree had been killed and cut off, but there was still life there, and there will be a branch, the righteous branch of Zechariah, the righteous branch in a couple of different places in the book of, in the prophecy of Jeremiah. So that's a good Hebrew word. Buni is a really interesting word. It's probably a perversion of B'nai, that means sons of, because Jesus gave a nickname to James and John. Remember that incident in Samaria, that little nasty situation where they wanted to wipe out a whole town because they wouldn't accept them in? They probably wouldn't give them kosher food. He began to call James and John Boanerges. You've read this in your own Gospels, right? In English, Boanerges. That's actually a Greek perversion of B'nai Regesh, sons of rage, or sons of thunder, yeah? So this Buni is probably connected to that B'nai, sons of B'nai Regesh. Okay, the last one is Todah, and it's just a word in Hebrew that means thank you. It's just some kind of a throwaway sort of thing. But we've got Jesus as a rabbi who had disciples, and that's the takeaway point on this. Never mind the Matthew and Nicodemus and everything else. We for sure have a Jesus who is a rabbi and has disciples. By the way, Josephus said that as well. His disciples did not abandon their discipleship when he was crucified, but they claimed that he was raised on the third day and appeared to them alive. So we've got this by multiple sources. All right. They crucified him, Babylonian Talmud, Tractate Sanhedrin. They crucified him on the eve of Passover. Pardon me for just a minute. Cha-ching. Thank you very much. Now we can get back to business. I mean, is that not right on the money? That's exactly what. It's called the day of the preparation of Passover. 3 p.m., that's when the lambs began to be slain. Bam. Gospels, Babylonian Talmud. Same thing. Their tradition among rabbinic circles, they're remembering the exact same day as the Gospels record. For what reason? Why did they crucify him? Because he practiced magic and enticed Israel to go astray. That's that Deuteronomy 13 thing again about the false prophet. If he shows a sign and a wonder, never mind that he shows a sign and a wonder. If he leads Israel astray to the worship of Elohim Acherim, other gods, what do? We'd make him a TV preacher. We'd take up an offering for him. What were we thinking? They stone him to death. That's the prophet that's stoned, is the one that leads astray to the worship of Elohim Acherim, other gods. Next, another text from the Tractate Sanhedrin. Rabbi Yochanan said, in the beginning he was a prophet, and in the end he was a diviner. Here's what he's trying to say. He had a good start, but some kind of way in the middle he lost his way. That is true of a lot of TV preachers and the rest of us as well. But Rabbi Papa said, this is what they say. She was the descendant of princes and governors, but played the harlot with carpenters. He kind of takes the tradition in a different way, starts talking about Miriam, Mary, the mother of Jesus, who was a descendant of princes and governors. What is she trying to say? She's of the line of David. And not only is Joseph in the Gospels of the line of David, Mary is also. Mary and Joseph, both from that line of David. They're both of royal blood. And then played the harlot with carpenters. That would be she and Joseph got together before they had actually legally gone through the marriage ceremony. It's again a claim of some kind of sexual irregularity that produced the birth of Jesus. Remember, Joseph and Mary show up in Bethlehem, and they are still not married, and she gives birth there as an unmarried Jewish woman, which is the height of controversy. So that's there in the Gospels, and that's being preserved by these sources as well. Next slide. This is the last one that I'm going to afflict you with tonight. There are others. I've kind of selected the cream of the crop. There's plenty more material. It's just some of it is a little harder to interpret. Some of it was a little bit harder to fit into this kind of a venue. But this last one is also from the rabbis. And the rabbis say, woe to him who makes himself alive by the name of God. And you've seen in this Babylonian Talmud, in the Tractate Sanhedrin, and in this general area, that there's a whole lot of discussion about the backgrounds and origins of Jesus, of his life, of his parentage, and that kind of thing. And all of a sudden, this statement just sort of pops out of nowhere. It's like somebody's sitting around, all of a sudden they woke him up. It's time, hey, Rabbi Joseph, it's time to go get lunch. And he goes, oh yeah, and by the way, you know, just before we conclude, before we adjourn, woe to him who makes himself alive by the name of God. Well, there is this tradition that if you could learn the holy name of God, the four letter in Hebrew, Yod Heh Vav Heh, or YHWH or YHVH, right? The name Yahweh. If you could learn that name and then you could properly pronounce it, that you could channel the power of God to do miraculous stuff that maybe God wouldn't necessarily approve of. In other words, you're kind of hijacking his power. That's the claim that here by these rabbis that, okay, yes, Jesus died. He died as a criminal. He was buried. He did come back alive, but that was faked also. That was not legitimate either. That was kind of like casting out demons or performing miracles by the power of Beelzebub. Yeah? So now they're saying this illegitimate use of power extended even to the grave and beyond the grave, because while we don't really like it, we've got to admit that Jesus was resurrected. But he was resurrected by a misuse of the power of God. He, some kind of way, got control of this divine name and was able to manipulate the power of the one true God to bring himself back to life. Do you see this? Woe to him. Woe to Jesus, who made himself alive by misusing the power behind this unspoken, difficult to get to, hard to pronounce name, Yahweh, Jehovah, however you want to pronounce it. And again, we've got really interesting trajectories right back into the gospel accounts. Just tell them that, tell them the dogs carried the body away. Tell them that his disciples some kind of way came and stole it. They paid the guards off. I mean, who knows? There's this attempt, even at the gospel level, to explain away this incredible life and history-changing event that we refer to as the resurrection of Jesus. Now, I've got about 10 minutes, maybe a little bit less, and I want to just run down through a series of things that this stuff we just looked at kind of establishes, okay? And when we look at it, we're reflecting on gospel realities, New Testament realities as well. But okay, there was a man who was called Jesus. All 17 of these ancient, late first, early second century sources establish that. We don't have to have the Bible to have that. Another, he was from a Jewish village, and I give the source there that provides that information. Yes, the New Testament says it, but so also does Celsus. He was his earthly father was a carpenter. Okay, we get this from the New Testament. We get this from extra-biblical literature. His mother's name was Mary. We know that from the Bible. We know that from sources outside the Bible, that Mary was of royal ancestry. She was of the line of David. We know that from the Bible, and we know that also from the rabbis. His family was poor. We know this from both texts, both sets of texts. He claimed virgin birth. We have that from both sets of texts. His opponents claimed that Mary was unfaithful. Okay, we have that from the Gospels. We also have that from the rabbis and from Celsus. We have that his opponents claimed that he was illegitimate. We got that from both sets of texts. That he escaped to Egypt. He later returned to Israel. We have that from both sets of texts. We have that he had a brother whose name was James. We have that from both sets of texts. That he was a teacher, both sets of texts. That he was a rabbi, both sets of texts. He had disciples, both sets of texts. He had founded a community that he referred to the members as brothers. We get that in the New Testament. We get that in these texts. And that he left behind a series of teachings or laws that we didn't have before. Okay? We call that the teachings of Jesus. It's the stuff in the red in your New Testament. Next. He was known to be wise, both texts, both sets. Known to be virtuous and godly, both sets. Known as a prophet, both sets. That he worked miracles, even though his opponents say that he used magic to get those miracles accomplished. Both sets of texts claim have this information available in them. His opponents say that he led Israel astray. That's both sets of texts, New Testament as well as what we've been looking at tonight. That he was called the Christ. Both sets of texts claim that, New Testament and the stuff we looked at tonight. That he claimed divinity or deity. Both sets of texts claim have this claim. Next, that he was worshipped by his earliest followers as God. Both sets of texts. He was condemned by a Jewish court on the eve of Passover. Both sets of texts. However, he was crucified, meaning that he was killed by Romans. That's a Roman form of execution. And both sets of texts tell us that. Pontius Pilate, Roman procurator, Roman form of execution. His earliest followers claim that he was resurrected from the dead. Both the New Testament and this set of texts say that's what his followers were preaching and teaching. That he was, quote, perhaps, according to Josephus, the Messiah. That's the assertion in the New Testament. Jesus the Messiah. That is what Josephus says his earliest followers were claiming. Consequently, every major assertion about the life and ministry, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth that we read about in our Gospels, in our New Testament, is corroborated by or is referred to by these extra-biblical, anti-Christian, except for Josephus, references, works. They corroborate who Jesus was and how he lived his life, what he did, what he accomplished. And these are all first century and early second century sources. What that means is evidently, ladies and gentlemen, that we have a very strong oral tradition that was being taught and preached by the earliest followers of Jesus that got out there into the non-Christian world, out there into the marketplace. I call it out there in the public domain. And so now what we actually have read tonight, although lots of different authors and different languages and that kind of thing, is we have read a fifth gospel. We've read the gospel of public domain. These guys are not sitting around studying the Greek texts of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and maybe some stuff in the book of Acts and letters of Paul. They're not doing that. They have their own traditions. Some of it goes well beyond giving details that we don't even have in our New Testament. You know, that she was a spinstress, that she was a dresser of women's hair, that kind of thing. That he brought back spells from Egypt with a cut in his leg. You know, that we don't hear anything like that. These guys are a little bit off on their own, but they have heard the Christian message. So when Dan Brown or anybody at your local community college is teaching your young students, well, you know what? All this stuff is just way late. It all got made up after the fact. This is all just make-believe. It's passed on, handed down, legend. And you know what? It's really circular reasoning to argue that Jesus even existed using the Bible. You can't use the Bible to support the Bible. Then what you can say is, well, that's really interesting. That's a neat perspective. Hey, I have a document I'd like to share with you. Would you mind just taking a look at what I've got here on my thumb drive or that I've got in my personal file here on my laptop or in my phone or wherever it is that you keep this stuff? You can download this off of the church's website. We'll make sure it's available to everybody. What we've got then is a separate and distinct fifth testimony to this most important life ever lived and most important death and return from the dead that has ever happened. And I think I find that compelling and significant. So I submit to you that, again, maybe not with geography, maybe not with some archaeological stuff except for that graffito of Alexamenos, I would suggest to you that, again, tonight faith has become sight right before your very eyes. And this is some fascinating stuff. I just trust that the Lord's going to bless you with it, is going to found you and ground you further in your trust in Him and in His Word, and that maybe this will spur you on to some more study, including some of the stuff that we do with all of you guys in Israel in March. More to come. God bless you all.